the calm sea. From the air, there's nothing much to see. An entire subcontinent of arid land, strewn with pebbles and bristly thickets, bounded by the vast, icy Antarctic Ocean, a rich treasure house of marine life. Over millions of years, the ocean has periodically invaded these plains, making the borders between land and sea only temporary in the time scale of evolution. Some of today's marine mammals were once creatures of the land. The adaptation of the dolphins to life in the sea is remarkable. Perhaps their only shortcoming is a dependence on oxygen from the atmosphere, which requires them to breathe regularly by raising the body out of the water. Dolphins have so many distinctive characteristics that even the most remarkable can only be summarized. Relative to body weight, their brains are bigger than ours, perhaps indicating a degree of mental power rare in the animal kingdom. Their skin's fatty tissue is able to enhance their agility, as it can vary its resistance to the water according to cruising speed. The dolphin's propulsion comes from the back section of the body, below the caudal, through the action of a pair of powerful muscles. But that's not all. Vertical waves of the whole body increase their speed to almost 50 kilometers per hour. They are, however, short-sighted, and they have very little sense of smell. They find their food through their acute sense of hearing. Dolphins are gentle and sociable creatures. It's easy to strike up a friendship. Many spontaneous relationships have developed between these aquatic animals and divers or swimmers. The most amazing facet of dolphins is that by emitting sounds, they can communicate with their kind. Five different species of dolphins swim in these Patagonian waters. Of these, the most abundant are the Fitzroy and the bottle snout, which we are observing now. But dolphins do not reign alone in these cold waters. The calm waters of the San Jose Gulf to the north and the Golfo Nuevo to the south of the Valdez Peninsula both play a very important role as an annual breeding ground for the free-ranging whales. The free-ranging whale of the south. Not among the largest of the cetaceans, but still big enough to make it almost impossible to understand how it can propel its huge mass out of the water. Because of the diminishing numbers of many whale species, it's understandable that researchers have intensified their efforts here. It is spring in the Gulf, and the waters are becoming warmer. Thank you. From the air, one can observe perfectly the arrival of the whales. Thanks to studies that have been made, we know that between 600 and 1,000 of these marine mammals come to the waters of the Valdez Peninsula each year. It can safely be estimated that this represents about 50% of the total population of the free-ranging whale. A number of the whales have been singled out for closer study. The researchers have given them names, and each individual whale is quite clearly recognizable by the distribution and size of the white patches on the head. An eminent marine biologist, Richard Payne, heads the research team. It's especially easy to recognize this individual, as it bears a huge scar, no doubt the result of an encounter with an ocean-going ship. But where do the free-ranging whales that are just arriving in Valdez come from? They've come a great distance. Their main source of food is a small crustacean called krill, which is most abundant in Antarctic waters. So it must be there, near Antarctica, that they will return after the breeding season along the Argentinian coast. Free-ranging whales must cover more than 1,000 kilometers. At a cruising speed of about 5 knots per hour, it takes long weeks to make the journey. Generally, cetaceans don't travel alone, but in schools of varying numbers. No one knows exactly why whales lift their massive 40 or 50,000 kilogram bodies out of the water in this way. Is it nuptial euphoria? Are they merely being playful? Does it help them to change skin? Or are they freeing themselves of tormenting parasites? This whale has become beached by strong currents. Centuries ago, this would have been a kind of manna from heaven for the local tribes, the Tehuelches, who at times would establish camp near a beached whale for long periods, living off its meat by salting and smoking it. Today, now that the original inhabitants are no more, only animal scavengers feed on the carcasses. But the dead whale offers us an opportunity for a closer look. The tail, transformed into a fin, joins the vertebral column, which tends to be flat and has a large quantity of vertebrae and ribs. In free-ranging whales, the dorsal fins are missing, but the pectoral fins, which correspond to our arms, are well developed. The most outstanding feature of their anatomy is the extraordinary development of the cranium. In effect, the head is a quarter of the total length of the body. The corneous laminae, which hang from the arched upper jaw, give these cetaceans their name. These bony plates, which are now considered part of the mouth, serve to filter water inside their gigantic throats. They are over 3 meters long and number about 7,000. The whales breathe through two nostrils on the upper part of the body. Because of their immense size, these whales do not have natural enemies. Nevertheless, they are threatened, facing extinction, in fact, because of human greed. But whales do face terrible and mortifying adversaries, various minute parasites which become embedded in their skin. The preferred sites for these small organisms are the snout, corners of the mouth, and the back of the head. This is where the whales have patches of white and wrinkled skin. As we saw before, these white calluses vary in shape and size from whale to whale and are unmistakable identification marks for the observer. It's worth noting that 60% of the body, which weighs between 40 and 50 tons, is made up of fat or blubber. The free-ranging whale can remain underwater for up to an hour, but in normal circumstances they alternate about 15 minutes of swimming on the surface with 5 or 10 minutes of submersion. You can get quite close to the whales in these calm waters. Not only do they tolerate humans, but it seems as if the gentleness of their movements is quite deliberate. This great cetacean is so careful, it's as if it knew that one swish of its tail could flatten the occupants of the boat. It's obviously the innate behavior of these creatures to be trusting and affable. They still don't sense that the presence of humans could mean their demise. They have been hunted in a way that is at once cruel and calculated. During the greater part of the last century, they were virtually exterminated by the then powerful American whaling fleet. The film crew observed that they behaved especially gently underwater. The whales not only tolerated their presence, but avoided all abrupt movements. Free-ranging whales reach the coastal refuges, the females are immediately pursued by one or more males. This may appear to be an imbalance in the sexes, but it is in fact because each male tries to mate with more than one female. Many female whales come to these waters to give birth rather than to mate. Sometimes one sees virtual merry-go-rounds, with whales going round and round, pushing, puffing, and even striking one another. The males can be so persistent that the females are forced to take evasive action. What they basically do is turn upside down and swim on their backs. After several days of chasing, and after rivals have lost interest, just one male proceeds with copulation. The mating takes place in very shallow water, and with both male and female on their side. The process lasts hours, and is repeated several times. The males of these species have the largest testicles in the animal kingdom, weighing almost 2 tons. Almost 1,000